let's return to This Week in America. Here's your host, Rick Bratton.
Welcome back, everybody. Coast to Coast, This Week in America. Helen Back is Optimum Vision's story. He was in two wars, one with Korea and one with his wife. His story starts during the Great Depression on his father's self-sustaining farm. Be it near-death experiences on the farm, in war, driving vehicles, building homes, marriage, heart attack, multiple bypasses, and the loss of his free movie sweetheart, Optimum learned how to be at peace with himself and God. This peace allowed him to establish his personal hells head-on, witness God walking him through them, and establish him again and take him through the next season of his life. Those experiences shaped him as a person, a parent, entrepreneur, philanthropist, author, and movie producer. Optimum Vision, author of Helen Back, is with us on This Week in America. Optimum, welcome to the program. It's great to have you with us.
Oh, thank you, Rick. It's going to be an experience I need to do to move on. So thank you for helping me.
Well, this is going to be our pleasure. This is such a fascinating story. And let's start with the inspiration for the book, Helen Back. Where did this idea for the book come from? How did this whole thing start?
Oh, wow. My dad did a lot of things in his life, but he didn't talk. He did. He was funny. He was witty. I didn't really realize how blessed I was to have my parents as parents. And until I became a father, you know, and then a grandpa myself, and looking back, and now my dad is dealing with the death of his free movie sweetheart. He met her when she was 13 years old. He was 16. He just decided to do, you know, one of them young boy things, to go to the movie. They were free. And then she's there, and it's just like one thing led to another. And now I'm on this side where he's missing her. He doesn't talk much, but he does in his actions. I'm thinking, Dad, let's write a book on your life. I mean, you got a full life here, and it made a huge impression on me. You make an impression on the people around you. Let's touch the world. No. Let me do that when I'm gone, you know. And he was that kind of like depressed, playing pool. Yes. He loves pool. We're slot pool player pros, you know, but we couldn't, we went professionally, we couldn't do it, but around the table for fun. Yeah. Well, then I just made up my mind. I had to engage the conversation. So I says, Dad, what's the name of your book? If you write your book of your life. And he goes, Helen Back. And that's the last thing I thought he would say, knowing him personally. And it was just like, I laughed, he laughed, we kind of like, I put my stick down. Just, wow. And then I got excited about doing the book, you know. Yes. And I go, okay, so why would you want to call your book, Helen Back? And he goes, because I was in two wars. I was in war with Korea and one with my wife. Both of us lost it down. We both put our sticks down. We quit playing, sat down in a chair, and just started talking. I just, oh, my goodness. I have the honor and privilege of helping my dad get through this part of his life and yet capture his moments of his life. Let's do a father-son interview kind of thing. You know, I was very fortunate to be sensitive to that.
Oh, yes.
And just I watched him heal in the process, but yet document the process. And then to the point where it's a book in his hand and he's holding it. And just for the first time, he's actually crying and he's smiling. I'm thinking, wow.
What an amazing moment. That had to be quite special. And obviously, it's you know, you describe it like it was an hour ago. You know, that happened when he sees this book for the first time. It's such a fascinating story. And the book is Helen Back. The author, Optimum Vision, and you'll spell that V-I-Z-H-A-N as you're Googling that. The book's available at Amazon, and we'll have information on our website, thisweekinamerica.us, as well. Let's talk about your father, the beginning. How was he born into this life? A fascinating a beginning for him. Talk about that.
He was a twin, but supposedly they didn't know it was twins. She was kind of a bigger woman and stuff. And so his sister comes out first, and it's like, there was this like moment of feeling like something's not right. There's gotta be more. The doctor realizes that there's another child up there, my dad, but he's not really going through the motions of being born. So they cracked open their J.K. Scrumpy, you know, their hard cider and drunk it and relaxed. And then he talks about, yeah, they didn't know I was up there. I was just playing around with them, you know. It's just like he was actually there and he knew that he was kind of like being a little, you know, he's going to, I'm different. I'm going to let you know I'm different. But I'm going to surprise you. And then yes, finally, you know, he comes out and just that whole moment of, and then when, as he's telling it, it's like the precursor of his whole life, what it was going to be.
Well, that's interesting.
He's going to make this.
Yeah, finish the thought. I'm sorry.
He's was going to make this mark, you know, on his, in his family's life and the people around him. And it's really neat how it was congruent with his whole life, looking back.
Yes, and how it shaped you, which is a fascinating story as well. And there was a time when he got a V scar on his forehead. He's like, I think, 5 years old, something like that. Talk about that, because that literally really shaped. There was a message there, wasn't there?
Yes. He being on a farm, you know, we normally think of having a dog as a family pet, basically. That's the common consensus. Well,
yes,
this farm, they had a buck sheep as their family pet. And it kind of, it interacted with them like a regular lifelong companion dog. And so, but in this case, with the ram, they have the horns. And so him being a little, not mischievous, but liking to live on the edge of things, he would kind of like play with it, and the buck sheep would kind of pick him up and lift him up and give him that air feel, and then kind of throw him in the air a little bit, and then he'd be down, being a 4 or 5 year old. And well, now as he's playing and getting used to that, it's kind of like fun and games. He kind of pushes the buck a little bit farther. Well, then the buck really pushes him, and it pushed him so hard he went into, back in that time, they had tractors with welded V's on them, on the rim of the tire.
Oh, okay. Yes.
You know, we look at it as rubber, but it was a steel back then before tires were applied to the tractors. He shoved his head, forehead, right into that V so hard that it opened his head up. And his dad's looking on, and it's like, he was a butcher as well. When the cows got to term and they really didn't have much, you know, use trying to utilize their farming system, they would butcher them. That buck sheep was their pride. I mean, his dad bragged about how much this buck sheep was. And in that moment, he's looking at his son hit, you know, underneath like the V-shaped tire of the tractor, bleeding, you know, and I'm assuming my dad's shocked and he's not moving, to the point where it moves his dad and he goes right over to that buck sheep, picks him up with one hand. This buck sheep's like 200 pounds, picks him up, and with a sheaf in his, like a butcher thing, in his other hand, cuts his head right off instantly, right in front of everybody. And I'm just like, wow. Here he was bragging about how much this buck sheep was in their family, this man, his father, and connecting with the community and stuff. And he sees his son falling right there, bleeding, his last son, his twin son. He didn't think twice. One of the kids, and just like that made an impression on him. As he comes to, you know, when he heals up, they didn't have, you know, the stitches back then, like, you know, we rushed the doctor, ER or whatever. So
yes,
he's got this visible V in his forehead. Well, as he gets older, he's got male pattern baldness. And it shows. And every time he goes into these difficult challenges, like, you know, that he caused, but in his, he looks at that V in the mirror, and he's like, you know, that V is for victory. I had victory in that situation. Yeah, I kind of acted on as an immature child, or a child growing up, you know, a toddler, but wow, I got through that. And my dad loves me so much. And it's just when he tells the story, he would stop and the water would come down his ears. And he's just,
yes.
My dad never told me he loved me, but doing that told me how much he really loved me.
Yeah, actions rather than words. And that was sort of the first experience, hell and back. I can see as you're going through all of his life, the situations. And when we look at it, we do as well. That's why the book is so powerful, because it gives us some inspiration and lessons that we all have our private hells from time to time, and we need to bounce back from them. That's the title of the book, Hell and Back. Optimum Vision is the author, and Vision is V-I-Z-H-A-N. Book available at Amazon, the usual places. Go to our website. We'll be able to link you up there as well. Boy, time going by so quickly. Let's talk about the Korean War for a little bit. What was it like for your dad being in the war, and particularly at the 38th parallel? What impression did that make on the rest of his life?
A huge, because they're at the tail end of the Korean War. They got like 3 months, but they didn't know that going over. He went through boot camp. That was real quick. It took a couple of days to get married because he didn't want to leave his sweetheart left wondering if they're going to get married on. So he got married. He brought closure with that. Went over. He's on the 38th parallel. Massive buildup, because this is towards the end, but they didn't know it was the end. And he's on there, and they're in their foxholes and stuff, and they know the next night they go, after this night that they're in day, they go in, and they go in waves. Every day, a new wave goes in, and they just go right in like an assembly line almost. And so they know it's their turn, and nobody's coming back. It's bloody. And they know, so each one is going through during the day. I didn't realize, I'm not a time checker, so I did the time during this time before that night. It's his birthday. So he's on the 38th parallel on his birthday, and he just occasionally smoked. So he's 21 years old, so now he can legally drink back then. But he wasn't much of a drinker, but he smoked. And so he's knowing the next day after his birthday, he's going in. And so then they get the night kicks in, and then the 38th parallel goes right through Bay City, Michigan. So I'm not very far. He's never been really far from that 38th parallel. So then it gets around midnight. These guys are just, you know, whatever God they have, or if they whatever, they know that they're not coming back tomorrow. Midnight, they declare peace. And I was just at awe and thinking, wow, again, God has delivered him.
Yes. Hell and back. That's why that's funny that your dad just sort of comes up with that title and catches you off guard as you're talking. But boy, that is so descriptive of so many phases of his life. And the book is a fascinating read. Time is going by way too quickly. So many interesting stories to talk about. Your dad's background in falling off the roof and a utility worker and building homes and in teaching you how to drive a nail, all of that. Let's talk about the other battle, the battle with Korea, the one with his wife. What would your dad say every time his wife would walk out on him? Because that was hell again that he had to bounce back from.
It's crazy, because even though I feel like I'm in this like more than larger than life feel looking back, now looking at it, it's like they were like a normal family. They had their differences. They had their way of looking things. And then when my mom, she was outspoken and said, that's it, I'm done. And even though she didn't have a job, cause she was a full-time mom, she walked out. She didn't believe or agree with what my dad was saying. She walked right out that door, and I'm watching her walk out that door. And this is like my inspiration. This is what holds the family together. Are you crazy? And I like speak up and say, Dad, you got to stop her. And he goes, no. And I says, what do you mean? I says, we need mom. And he goes, no. He says, she'll be back. And I go, how do you know? And he says, because nobody else will be able to put up with her.
Okay.
And I go, I got thinking about that. And I go, wow, he knows her so much. He's allowing her to vent her way.
Then, yes. And it'll all work out in the end, I guess. And he knew exactly how to handle her. But what an impression that made on your life. There was a motto that your dad lived by. A couple minutes left in the show. Tell us about that, because that's important not only for you, but it's something we all can learn from.
Very, work hard, sleep hard, play hard. If I work hard, I'm going to sleep hard. If I don't work hard, I'm going to have a hard time sleeping. If I work hard and I sleep hard, when I got time off, I'm going to play hard. That's his whole point.
Boy, and it says it in few words, and those are words to remember and words that you remembered. And again, time going by quickly, but what impact has this had on you? You had this relationship with your father, a lot of it by just seeing what he was doing, and you had this closeness, you had the opportunity to tell his story. What's this been like for you?
Oh, wow. It's the common staple through everything I do, other than, you know, okay, he went out. The key thing in the whole thing is I go, okay, you were married to mom 62 years. What did you get out of that? He says, you know, oh, let me go back. You've been in the Korean War and you did all that stuff. And what did you get out of it? Well, besides war's not good, what did you get out? And he says, it taught me how to deal with marriage. I go, wow, that's deep.
Yeah.
You're in a situation you don't really want to be in, but you are, and you got to survive. And how are you going to survive to make this work? And he says, that really opened my eyes that in my relationship with my free movie sweetheart, that I'm going to have that same dedication in my relationship with her. And then I says, okay, you've been married to mom 62 years. That's kind of a rarity in our society now. We don't see people that long.
No, not at all.
They have a conflict and they just kind of like try to make it happen. And they don't. I said, so what did you get out of that whole thing? He says, you know, I didn't realize how much I loved my free movie sweetheart until I learned how to love her unconditionally. 24/7 to the point I do it automatically. I want to do that automatically so that I can enjoy loving her unconditionally. That blew me away. That just like superseded everything.
So many important lessons. Your dad was such a wise man, and it's just so grateful that we are as readers that you were able to capture this story, because we get to know him and we also get to some of that advice that kept him going through life as he encountered his hells and then bounced back. Tell me about the end. I've got a minute or so here. How did your dad leave the world?
Well, that was, I did not see it coming. He didn't want to be in a nursing home. He wanted to be with his family. He wanted to go old school way, you know, no hospice, nothing. So he's in my home. He's having a hard time the Friday before. And I'm thinking, Dad, it's time for diapers. No, I don't want to wear one. And it's just like he was starting to shut down. I didn't know it. But that Monday when I'm getting around for work, I'm down in the basement so my dad can live on the first floor without having to deal with steps and stuff. My dog usually goes in sync with me. That morning, my dog just like went ahead and he sat outside his room, his door of his room. While I'm getting around, I get up there and I open the door. My dad's laying on the floor and up until that time, he was singing like for 20, 30 minutes. He was just singing. And it was kind of a peaceful thing. I think that's really strange. He never done that before. I've never been. And it's kind of like a peaceful, tranquil.
Yes.
My dog coming up here, sitting by the door, he was like at peace too. And then, so I open the door and my dad said, my dog goes in. He acts like he's a nurse. He's not acting like a dog. And it just blew my mind away that how I was going in the smoke. Didn't know it at the time. And I said, Dad, you know, and he just kind of connected. And he's kind of like got this peaceful look on his face. He's looking at me. Didn't know that he was going to pass. And then I'm helping him out. He didn't want to say anything. So I'm just kind of interacting with actions. And he's responding. Just relax, Dad. I'll be back. I had to go to work. Just lay right here, Dad. You're fine. Here's your water. Spoons. Don't put that. Get back. He was gone. He passed away. So I'm thinking, oh, my goodness. He left the mark coming in this world by a hesitation of that moment to say, hey, things are going to be different now. And then here he is having that moment of just being caught up in the spirit, at peace with himself, singing, and my dog's at peace with it. And I'm just, wow, I actually had the honor and privilege of this guy's last few moments.
It's just,
he made a mark. He made a mark on my life, just like he made a mark, like that V on his forehead.
Yes. And he will leave that mark with others who read the book, Helen Back, the author. The name of the book, when you're looking it up, is Optimum Vision, and that's V-I-Z-H-A-N. We'll take 30 seconds here. Are you working on any other books? I know you've written some others, and you're a very talented writer. Are you working on anything else right now?
Yeah, I'm working on a children's book. I thought I'd take a little break, and I've been doing self-helps, you know, and stuff like that. So
yes.
I'm thinking I'm going to do a children's book.
Oh,
and do a little, you know, just pictures and a few words kind of thing. And help me make this transition from taking care of my dad and writing his life story and dealing with stuff. So
yes.
I hope to be back if you let me back on.
I would love to have you back. There's so much more to talk about, and we're out of time. So buy the book. The book is Helen Back by Optimum Vision, and we'll have Clarence back on the program to talk about the new book that he is working on. And again, Vision is V-I-Z-H-A-M-N, Optimum Vision. The book is Helen Back. You'll find information on our website, thisweekinamerica.us. Amazon is the place to go, but wherever books are sold, you'll find a copy there as well. Clarence, a pleasure having you on the program to share the story of your dad. The book is going to be an inspiration to so many people, as his life was shaping you and others. Thank you for being with us on the program today.
Oh, thank you, Rick. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Take
it's been
care.
A pleasure. You as well. Optimum Vision is the title of the author listed on the book. The book is Helen Back. Information on our website, thisweekinamerica.us. And we're back on today's program after these messages.
This Week in America is online. You can visit our website, thisweekinamerica.us. Scott Pinkerton, associate producer of This Week in America. Jay Anderson, segment producer. Ben Watson, webmaster. Otto Bechet, director of engineering and TV production. This Week in America produced and is a trademark of Blue Funk Broadcasting, LLC. For information on all of our guests and to listen to this week's show, our website again at thisweekinamerica.us. And I'm Sean Bratton, executive producer of This Week in America.